You're about to witness something few people ever get to see. An animal that spends its entire life in the ocean, yet after decades underwater, crawls on land to give birth. Scientists call her Caretta Caretta, and this is her destiny. She is driven from the water by instinct. It takes great effort to drag her body across the sand. When she finally finds a safe spot above the reach of ocean waves, she is tired. But the urge to lay her eggs is overwhelming. She begins to dig. To do anything less is to risk extinction. Caretta, Caretta. Better known as Loggerhead. To show you these amazing reptiles, we teamed up with biologist Mark Dodd, who heads the Sea Turtle Program for the Department of Natural Resources. It was decided that Ossabaw Island would give us the best shot to actually capture video of a nesting loggerhead.
So why Ossabaw?
Well, we came to Ossabaw because it's one of our three main loggerhead nesting beaches. Those include Cumberland, Ossabaw, and Blackbeard. So for one reason, it's a place where we know we're going to have a lot of turtle nesting. It's also a place where there's no development. And it's turtles have been doing their thing at night, completely undisturbed since the beginning of time.
There is another reason. You can count the number of people who live here on one hand. And that means no artificial lights on the beach, which confuse nesting turtles and their babies. Ossabaw is owned by the state and preserved as a natural area. Just south of Savannah, this 26,000-acre island is undeveloped, something that is abundantly clear on our half-hour drive to the North Beach. Except for this dirt road, there aren't many signs of civilization. When we finally reach the beach, Mark puts red plastic on the headlights.
It's not that turtles don't see red at all, they see it, but for whatever reason, they're just less disturbed by it.
We spend hours riding up and down the beach, hoping to see a nesting loggerhead.
So I'm just looking for the hump, right?
Yeah, you're looking for something big coming out of the water, and I'm gonna just survey looking forward down the beach.
One night, we searched the beach from 8 o'clock at night until 6 o'clock the next morning. No turtles.
No crawls.
No, not so far.
Then, a week later, we see crawl tracks. Follow them, and there she is. Mark makes a rare exception and allows us to use light to capture this video because of its value as an educational tool. Our girl doesn't seem to mind at all. She uses those back flippers like a hand, digging down as far as she can, pulling out sand, then casting it away. She will create a pit deep enough to hold an average of 100 eggs or more. While she's preoccupied, we are able to belly up beside her.
Is this a
Georgia turtle?
So yeah, it is. It's a Georgia turtle, and you know, Georgia loggerheads have a pretty fantastic natural history, and it starts and ends right here on a Georgia beach. So, you know, we're on Osaba Island. It's mid-July, and this is a turtle that probably hatched from an egg either on this island or on a nearby island.
She is not extremely large for a loggerhead, but they don't become sexually mature until the age of 30 or 35 years. So we know she's been out in the ocean for a long time. This may well be her first nest. The eggs are like rubbery ping pong balls. As they begin to pile up, you realize what a miracle of nature this is. Within the next month, she will dig on average 4 more nests and lay about 100 eggs every time.
Does she know we're here?
She probably knows we're here, but she's so committed to finishing that she's gonna complete the nest regardless of our presence. And so what she's doing now is she's just finishing up trying to camouflage the nest. So obviously she's throwing a lot of sand in our face and using her front flippers and her back flippers to throw sand around to try to camouflage the nest so predators won't be able to find it and dig up the eggs and eat them.
We don't move until she does. And then we follow her out to sea. She stops often to rest. She's hauling the equivalent weight of a refrigerator across the sand, using only her flippers.
Yeah, she's tired, and obviously she's not built to move quickly on the land. They're really graceful in the water, and you know, move fairly easily. But on land, they're heavy, and they don't have the skeletal structure or the muscles to move quickly. So it's definitely a struggle.
Clumsy on land, loggerheads are extremely graceful underwater. This is where they live. The only time you see them on land is if they're nesting, stranded, or injured, which means you rarely see a male. It is the largest hard-shelled turtle in the world, and its name comes from that big blocky head designed for crushing things like crabs and lobsters. It is an oddity of nature that females return to their birthplace to lay eggs. Thousands upon thousands of loggerheads have been born on the coast of Georgia. Occasionally, we catch the turtle dance when they rock their bodies back and forth to pack down the sand. And always, there is that slow crawl back to the ocean. Researchers put a tag on loggerheads whenever possible.
Scales. We'll put it in the first big scale here, next to the body. Put this on here.
Oh, she didn't like that.
She didn't like that.
But that tag plays an important role. There is a huge worldwide network of people who monitor beaches during nesting season. These tags are like a driver's license, letting anyone know where the turtles come from. A second pit tag is placed in her shoulder and will stay there for life.
What do these tags do? How has it helped you all in determining how far these turtles actually go?
Well, probably more importantly, the tags are used on tagging beaches to answer basic biological questions like how many times a season do females nest? How many years between nesting events do they stay out before they come back to the beach? But also it gives us some information on movement patterns as well.
So is she free to go now?
Yep, she's free to go. She's been tagged.
All right, go, girl.
When you visit Ossabaw, it's easy to lose track of time. We stay with Kate Pagan and Steve Tye, part of Georgia's conservation program. They spend 5 months a year on the island, checking the nests every day. Sound like fun? Well, think again. Every morning at dawn, they ride along the beach looking for crawl marks that would indicate a turtle has nested. They follow those marks to each nest and probe until they can actually find it. The sand feels different. It's loose where the turtle buried her eggs.
How many?
117.
They always take one egg for genetic research. But if the nest is too close to the high tide mark, they move it to higher ground. Each egg is removed in the order it was found. And the bucket is kept in the same direction, so the eggs will be placed in a new nest in exactly the same way they were laid. Then every nest is covered with wire and plastic mesh to keep wild pigs, raccoons, and other predators from digging in for a quick meal.
One down.
One down.
You may still think, piece of cake. But Ossabaw has four beaches, and this year it has 450 nests. Each one is checked every day, and 30% of them have to be moved to much higher ground. Kate and Steve watch over all those nests until the babies hatch about 2 months after the eggs are laid.
That's rewarding.
Yeah, it's definitely rewarding. And this island is something special in its own right. So just the opportunity to be here on Ossabaw and get to live on the island and have that, you know, the price of that, I guess, is to do this turtle work. But it's definitely rewarding. It's a good workout for the summer. You get to be on the beach every day. There's a lot
of
fun.
You feel like you're making a difference?
Sure. Well, we are making a difference.
How many hatchlings have we saved? Do you know?
I think it's around 15,000.
Yeah. That's just as of now, so we still have half of our nest to hatch.
Shortly before sun breaks the next morning, we get a chance to see why all of this is worth the effort. Here they come, tiny little packages of pure instinct, programmed to move forward like the Energizer Bunny. One by one, they make their way toward the ocean. Even the smallest thing can be an obstacle. Yet they keep going as if nothing else matters. And that is true. Nothing else does matter. Their only chance of survival is to make it to the ocean. They are drawn to the horizon, which is why artificial light confuses them so much. They go for the surf, and once there, they battle wave after wave until they can hit open water and start their power stroke. They will swim up to 48 hours nonstop until they reach a system of ocean currents known as the North Atlantic Gyre. They drift along in this system, which takes them from Georgia all the way across the Atlantic, down past the west coast of Africa, then back across the equator.
So once they run out of energy, they sort of slow down and they just start to float and they become essentially planktonic. They're like little pieces of driftwood. They're not really strong enough to swim against the currents and the wind out there, and so they basically are at the mercy of the ocean current patterns.
They will spend the first 8 to 15 years of their life in the high seas, drifting with the seaweed and living off those nutrients.
When you're a small, tiny little loggerhead hatchling, and you know, you're basically a bite-sized food morsel for anything, the majority of the predators are concentrated along the coastlines. And so the best place to be, where you're least likely to be eaten by something, is out in the middle of the ocean, where there's less predators.
But how do they know where to go? Researchers spent years trying to understand how those little hatchlings knew immediately in which direction to swim. It is now believed loggerheads have a built-in GPS system and use the Earth's magnetic fields to keep on track. Biologist Ken Lohman exposed babies that had never been in the water to different magnetic fields. They were able to change course and head in the direction of the Gulf Stream almost every time. As they mature, it is believed the ability to use these magnetic fields becomes even stronger. That's how Georgia hatchlings make it back home decades later. Through genetic research, we know there are even mother and daughter loggerheads nesting in Georgia, meaning some of these turtles are 60 to 70 years old. But even after decades of survival, when they reach the waters of home, they are in danger. They named her Lucy. She was seen on Jekyll Island, ready to nest, just before something hit her hard.
This turtle was photographed on the beach on May 31st, and it was completely healthy, no injuries, and then came back up on the beach several weeks later with limited use of its back flippers and seemingly unable to lay eggs in the sand.
Dr. Terry Norton at the Georgia Sea Turtle Center wants to save her, but she has no use of her back flippers. The injuries are major.
Gotten a lot of the dead bone out of there and dead tissue, but it's still pretty bad.
The center is doing everything possible to save her. The question is whether her spinal cord is severed completely or if there's hope for recovery. There is one certainty. Lucy collided with a boat.
Usually with a prop wound, the propeller is very sharp and it moves quickly. And as it's spinning through the water, the blades usually cut very cleanly into the shell. So that tells us that this is a right-turning propeller because the propellers have a curve on them. And if it's a deep wound that goes deep into the animal, you're going to get a curve, the same curve that you have on the prop blade.
Nesting loggerheads are unintended targets for boat strikes because of their breathing patterns. They come up from the bottom, take a breath, then drop down about a foot or two below the surface. They may do this two or three times before going back down to the bottom. And there's another problem. When turtles are nesting, they stay about 3 miles off the coast, right where all the boat traffic is.
Once you get to be a big female like this, you've survived many threats, and you have to stay around for a long time and produce lots of eggs to ultimately replace yourself. And so we really want to protect these nesting females. They're the most important, most valuable members of our population. And so when you see these kind of injuries, yeah, it's obviously something we want to avoid. It's not a good thing.
Ultimately, the injury was too severe. After making that long journey as a little hatchling, and surviving in the ocean for decades, Lucy had to be euthanized. At Georgia Tech's Savannah campus, engineering professors and students have been working to find a way to stop these injuries. The first step was to create a fake turtle shell with the same properties as a real one. Then, at a site on the Ogeechee River, they ran over those shells with different boats at different depths.
Is it your hope that eventually there's a boat or a propeller you can recommend? I mean, is that the ultimate goal?
It is. I mean, there's the purpose of the study is several-fold. One, we want to be able to better interpret the wounds that we see. We want to know what types of vessels are interacting with turtles, where they're interacting with turtles. And we want to know if there's a way that we could, if there are interactions between boats and sea turtles, if we can minimize the effects, and hopefully those won't be fatal interactions.
Meanwhile, the law enforcement arm of DNR is tackling another problem.
Cap, how long has it been since you were boarded? Pull them in. Go ahead and pull them up for us.
Many sea turtles die when they're caught in shrimp nets, so a turtle exclusion device, like that round circle you see being measured, is mandatory. It's not enough that the device is in the net. It has to be set at a proper angle or the turtle cannot escape.
Yeah, 55 is the maximum, and it's 65 to 70, basically. He's showing you how much you have to change to make it legal.
The device, better known as a TED, was developed by a Georgia fisherman. And shrimpers risk having their boats pulled in if they don't comply. The Turtle Conservation Network has made major strides in increasing the population of loggerheads. Hundreds of volunteers are trained to identify loggerhead tracks.
When you're training interns early in the season, there's no nest for them to use, so we use this method to make an artificial crawl on the beach, and it works great at parties and to fool your friends at night on the beach, but all you do is lay on your back.
So your elbows would be her front
flippers, and my feet are back flippers up against the dune. This is gonna be a false crawl, non-nesting emergence.
I'm on the armadillo.
Oh, okay. We'll move the dead armadillo out of the way. You compare that with the real crawl here. It's not too bad, right?
No, but could you do that again?
Get out of here, no way. That's it, I got enough sand in my underwear for one day, I'm good.
Worldwide, there are thousands of people watching for those crawls and protecting the nests. Joseph Capello is one of 100 volunteers on Tybee Island, waiting for the hatchlings to make their epic swim.
And when they get in the water, and you see that little head pop up right before they go right into the crashing wave to go out in the ocean. It's just neat to see that you think there's one that one might make it. And so you just hope that they do, and you know, that's kind of what we're here for, make sure that they make it.
On St. Simon's, Gloria Ramsour heads up an equally committed group.
On our island, because it's public, we are a totally volunteer group, and we keep about 10 to 12 guys and gals, young and old, who patrol this beach during the nesting season in the very early morning, first light or before first light. And we have to contend with the fact that this is a public beach.
One thing we cannot do is make more beaches. If you look at this map, you can see how important those undeveloped islands are. Asabaw, where we spent most of our time, tops the chart with the most nests. Habitat loss is just one more issue the turtles have to deal with.
You know, we all think loggerheads are really cool, and you know, they're magnificent animals, and we want to make sure they always nest here. And that I think that is important, but also, it's important to recognize that loggerheads, because of their unique natural history and the fact that they use the entire North Atlantic at some point during their life history, makes them a very valuable animal as an indicator species. So although we're trying to recover loggerheads and make sure they're always here,
They're a great indicator of the health of the ocean ecosystem. And ultimately, that's the ecosystem upon which we depend.
The ancestors of loggerheads have been around over 100 million years. But because their numbers dropped significantly, they are now protected under federal law and listed as endangered in Georgia. Turtle biologist Archie Carr wrote, "For most of the wild things on Earth, the future must depend upon the conscience of mankind." With the help of many agencies and individuals, loggerheads appear to be stabilizing. But there is still a great deal about their lifespan we don't know. And in many respects, the conservation work has just begun. Only a small percentage of baby loggerheads live long enough to make it back home. But if and when they do, there's a large network of people living on this coast standing guard to protect them. I'm Sharon Collins. We'll see you next time.